Heartfelt thanks to Brilliant, who is sponsoring this video. More on that later, because today we have a hot topic to dig into: containers versus virtual machines. Are you sure you understand the difference between the two? While going through a challenge building Docker with Go, I realized I hadn't quite grasped what a container is. Let me ask you this question. Do you know under which conditions running a Docker container is at least as expensive, computationally, as running a virtual machine? If you don't know the answer to that question, stick around. We'll be working out the answer to that and to more, such as what is a virtual machine, what is a container, what are the differences between a container and a virtual machine, why is a container more lightweight, generally speaking, what are the drawbacks of using a container when compared to a virtual machine. And the first step to answering these questions is to understand what a virtual machine is. The film The Matrix asks, are we living in a simulation? For virtual machines, the answer to that is yes. A virtual machine, or VM for short, is software pretending to be a computer. Now, what is the structure of our computers? They have hardware, that is, a CPU, memory, a hard drive, and so on. On top of that, we have an operating system. And on top of the operating system, we have the software. The software is actually where the virtual machine lives. A virtual machine is basically simulated hardware. It has a virtual processor, a virtual hard drive, virtual memory, and so on. It's software pretending to be hardware. In turn, the simulated hard drive contains a whole new operating system and software. This is what allows us, for example, to run Linux on Mac or on Windows. This is also the tech that allows us to run simulated mobile phones and tablets, which tend to have processors with an ARM instruction set on our computers. And for those of you who are wondering, yes, you can run VMs inside VMs inside VMs, although there is a limit to that. Now, why is that? Well, because simulating a whole system can be costly. Not only does the computer have to run its own operating system, but it also has to run simulated hardware and the guest operating system, and then any software that's running on top of that. And this is precisely where containers come in. Now, conceptually, containers share a lot with virtual machines. In a sense, they're the next step in the evolutionary path that virtual machines started. But that also causes a lot of confusion as to what exactly the difference is between the two. But that's why we're here, isn't it? To understand exactly what containers are. And that is why I'm so excited that Brilliant is sponsoring this video. If you don't know Brilliant, it's a fun and easy way to learn the fundamentals to boost your programming journey. Brilliant covers subjects like math, logic, and computer science, and more, with content being added regularly. What's so fun is that you learn to grasp the concepts quite literally with visual and kinetic examples that allow you to see and feel exactly what's going on. For example, the Computer Science Fundamentals course uses a bakery to help illustrate parallel processing. Brilliant manages to be both fun and challenging. I've been programming for, well, decades now, and I was surprised at how much fun I've been having and how much I was learning. So if you want a free power-up to your learning journey, head to brilliant.org/codeappsacademy. And for those of you wanting to go even further, they do have a paid plan with a 30-day free trial, and the first 200 to subscribe via this link get 20% off. Now, talking of going further, why are containers the next step after virtual machines? Well, let's take a look at exactly what containers are and how they improve on virtual machines. In a nutshell, virtual machines add, but containers subtract. They take a slice out. Let me explain. Let's get back to our computer with its three layers. If we dive into the operating system layer, it too has layers with different roles. The deepest layer, the kernel, interfaces directly with the hardware. A container is a walled-off slice of the environment which sits on top of the kernel. It has its own personal but limited share of the memory and of the hard drive and the CPU processes that it can use. It can't see the rest of the environment. It can't access any part of the file system, memory, or processes that don't belong to it. It simply speaks to the same kernel as the rest of the computer to interact with the hardware. So it shares the same hardware and part of the operating system. All it can do to communicate is to use its share of the network hardware to send and receive network messages, including to other containers on the same computer. Because the computer shares the hardware and the OS instead of simulating them, a container is generally less expensive to run than a virtual machine. However, there is a situation when a container is more expensive than a virtual machine. Can you see when that would occur? And that question brings us to container technology's strengths and weaknesses, and the question, why use containers instead of virtual machines? Now, I've mentioned that containers are lightweight. That's their first strength. Containers' second strength is that they're disposable. At first glance, that might seem like a weakness, but a disposable environment is also one that has a controlled, repeatable behavior. Now that has two important advantages. First, it means that a container on my machine works exactly the same as one on yours. It avoids the, well, it runs on my machine syndrome that I've seen so many devs resort to, and to be honest, I've used that excuse too. Second, a lightweight, repeatable environment is easy to scale up and down depending on the need. Disposability provides scalability. Now, containers also come with several costs and downsides. First, there's a setup cost. It's harder to configure an environment within a Docker container precisely because the configuration needs to be repeatable. Second, containers are also less secure than virtual machines because they're closer to the final hardware, so a weakness in the isolation could spell trouble. Now, there is another weakness, and it's the answer to the question, when is a container more expensive than a virtual machine? You see, containers are repeatable. Well, what happens if I have a Mac and you're running Linux? Surely a walled-off section of a Mac machine and a Linux machine won't work in exactly the same way. So how do container services run on non-Linux machines? Well, they run a virtual machine that runs Linux. So when is running a Docker container more expensive than running a VM? When you need a VM to run the Docker container. That being said, if running one container on one VM is more expensive than just running a VM, running a bucket load of containers on a server is a lot less expensive than spinning up the same number of virtual servers. Or to phrase things differently, the cost is worth it. Now, if you're interested in getting more hands-on knowledge, I suggest you follow the Docker building challenge that I went through. I provided a link in the description. And in any case, I'll see you in the next video.